Welcome back to The Big Issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. Now, we want to get into the details of the biggest story of the week. This week, Jacqueline Aserua cohabited with Ambayo since 1989 and later married in the Roman Catholic Church after 16 years of cohabitation. Jacqueline was then 19 years and Ambayo was 24 years old. Ambayo sponsored Jacqueline's education to finish primary 7 and, of course, graduating with a diploma. Today, Jacqueline is 52 and Ambayo is 57. They both have 4 children. Now, in 2007, the marriage developed irretrievable differences, which led to Jacqueline filing a divorce case against Ambayo in 2012. The High Court, then presided over by the Lady Justice Honorable Catherine Bamugemere, ruled that the couple should share their matrimonial property by a half on grounds that even when the property is in Ambayo's names, the property is still owned by the two. Now, Ambayo was dissatisfied with this ruling and appealed the judgment in the Court of Appeal. Now, on Tuesday this week, Court of the Appeal, presided over by 3 justices, that's Lady Justice Elizabeth Mosoke, Justice Mohamed Chibedi, and Justice Christopher Gashirabake, ruled that marriage does not give a spouse automatic half share in the matrimonial property upon divorce, thereby directing that Jacqueline be given 20% of the value of the matrimonial property, and share must be determined by one's contribution to the property making. Now, the ruling was welcomed by a section of public, of course, some cultural and religious leaders, and of course, some lawyers. However, it was condemned by the Uganda Women's Lawyers Association, that's FIDA, which argued that Jacqueline should appeal the ruling in the Supreme Court. Now, what is matrimonial property? What is it deemed fair in matrimonial property upon divorce, and who should take what in such circumstances? There are many cases of this nature. We want to understand how can divorce be managed and who should actually take what in case there is a separation between the couples. My guests today are Susan Baruka, is a legal officer with Uganda Women Lawyers Association, FIDA, and Pastor Asha Namanya, pastor at Trinity Christian Church in Lubaga. We want to actually have an understanding of this whole subject so that when you are thinking of this most accord divorce, you must bear in mind some of the grounds and also some of the things that you must have to bear in mind. Thank you so much, lady and gentlemen, for joining me this morning. Let me start with Susan, because I know she dissents from that ruling. Before we even get into other discussions of, other matters, why are you dissatisfied with this? Because looking at the facts of the case and looking at where Ambayo is coming from, he told the lady from primary to diploma level, and then the woman upon divorce wants to take his 50%. Is that fair? And who should protect Ambayo in this case? For example, we have to go by Lady Justice Catherine Bamugemere's ruling.
Thank you very much. First of all, why do I disagree? Why do we disagree as FIDA with this judgment? First and foremost, the woman was not seeking to take his 50%. She was seeking to take their 50%. 50% of what they acquired as a couple in marriage. Right? And of course, there is this allusion to the fact that he took her to school. You know, in this course on development of family law, that is what we call human capital development, where people want to take into account the other person to the other party's human capital development. Oh, I took you to school. But you see, it's not even just about I took you to school. The woman providing all this care work that enabled this man to, continue doing whatever he was doing. I'm sure he also was able to upgrade, maybe academically, maybe professionally. All that is part of human capital development. Even his ability to be able to go to work because of whatever it is she was doing back home and with her children is also a part of a contribution to his human capital development as an individual. Otherwise, it wouldn't be an issue for young people who are not able to get jobs because they don't have, quote unquote, the experience.
The property in question, the matrimonial property in question, because I wanted you to explain what it is in the first place, but the property in question is in the names of Ambayo Joseph, who actually constructed this property. And then Aseruwa, you know, she was arguing that in her, you know, defense, she was arguing that she contributed about, you know, supervising the construction and all that. Yet actually, Joseph is a super constructor, meaning that he knew what it was taking place, and, you know, the contribution of Jacqueline is worth 20%.
Okay, so now when you're talking about matrimonial property, first and foremost, matrimonial property is beyond what both parties contributed to financially. It is part of it, but it is beyond that. So even if you're to discard Jackie's supervisory role in the construction of the home...
They're not discussing it. They're only quantifying it to 20%.
So that's just it. At the end of the day, whatever the other party does, because when we say that we are getting married, if we are to take it out even of the legal discourse and just look at it from the social context, as I'm sure Pastor will look at it from that.
Mm.
Even when you're to look at it from the social context, but we all know that the personal is political, so it informs how legislation is done.
Susan,
it informs
what is matrimonial property. Because I have my house and I marry somebody. I marry a woman, for example, because that's what, you know, most cases are about. You already built your house, or it's, you know, near a completion. And then this woman comes into your family. She wants to claim 50% upon divorce. How fair is this? What constitutes matrimonial property and what doesn't?
Matrimonial property is the property that a couple chooses to call home, where they reside. It is property that is acquired during the marriage. Because when you look at the already existing precedents, which were there before even Catherine Bamugemere's judgment in this particular case, it is that property which both parties have acquired because there is an understanding, an appreciation of the fact that whatever the other person does somehow has ultimately contributed to acquiring whatever, in this case, Ambayo, acquired during the time when they were together. So matrimonial property is just, in a nutshell, those two things: property that you acquire together, property that you acquire
during
the
marriage.
Yes,
even when actually there's no contribution that you have made on this property,
even when
and
there
the
is
paper
no
is saying that this is my property.
yes, and I will take you back.
And this is what actually the court quashed. The court is looking at the paper,
and we are saying that the court is looking at the issue of contribution,
yes,
looking at it from a very capitalistic and very patriarchal point of view.
I will come back to you. Let me just bring in Pastor, because these lawyers and these women activists, for that matter, will actually take you in a different direction. But I want you to actually make a comment on this. Was the court fair? Because when you look at the grounds, they are clear. These guys have been married for, you know, over 16 years cohabiting, and then later on from 1989, you cohabited with somebody's daughter. She has given you 4 children, and then upon divorce, you are giving her 20%, and yet she's now 52 years. She can't really, you know, use her youth in realize another dream.
Okay.
How fair is this, and how fair unfair is this?
Thank you. I think I love the discussion, but the only challenge now I see in this is that, you see, every time you want to monetize marriage, that's one, number one failure, because it's a danger and it's going to cause a lot of conflict. So, for example, the foundation matters a lot, how you began. You can see that the man paid for the lady
for
quite some time.
And
so if you want to quantify, it might be a little bit hard compared to the other person's role. So here I think it should be, in my opinion, and then I'll give you God's perspective of how actually he sees
the divorce.
So me, I would think that a couple should first lay a better foundation before even they go into the marriage. And the challenge is that in the Old Testament, it used to be very okay. And then as years went by because of, you know, the devil has entered into the marriage, into the family, it is creating, it is being monetized. So basically it's having a lot of issues. And that's, those are the results that we are seeing right now. So for me, I think the best way would be, we would go by God's word.
But we shall
become one. Like, I mean, okay, I could have spent like 60 years and acquired my property, but then I make a decision at a particular time, I want to, let's say, get married to her. Now, I have come, I have proposed to her, she has accepted. It means that I have considered everything around me, and I see she's the right person to be with me. So now we have come, we have become one.
One.
Now, in the instance where we have some challenges, because, you know, the law of the land will say, you know, when you're getting, you know, divorced, this is what should be considered, and the contribution and all that. But you see, in the Christian perspective, it's a bit different. And God actually does not lay out how the property should be divided in case a person wants to leave.
In other words, in your faith, there is no divorce.
There is no divorce in God's eyes, because he believes that you love each other, you trust in God, and why should you even think about divorce in the first place?
Now, in the first place, from the onset, there is no divorce in the Christian perspective.
Yeah, in the Christian
meaning that what we are talking about is outside the scope of the Christian. Let's take it in the, because you interact many times with these people socially.
Yes.
And on different, you counsel them, you talk to them. What should be actually, how can these cases be handled? Should they really be handled using the legal brains? Should be handled using people, you know, very important persons and eminent citizens in the country presiding over such hearings? And should we consider even the law or religion in determining such cases? Because when I may agree with the ruling,
yes,
but I'm not in the shoes of Jacqueline.
Yes.
You have spent all your youthful years with this man, and this man is saying, because I owned the property before, I am giving you 20%. Is that being fair?
I think in my perspective, it's not really fair. Now, you see, the challenge we have is that legislation is being based on feelings.
Yes.
Like, it's, so people legalize based on their feelings. If I pass through a certain situation, and maybe I didn't like my wife at a particular point, now I want to use that particular feeling to regulate the law, which is a wrong perspective. So in this case, when they're doing legislation, I think they should include the religious leaders, people who understand maybe God's word and give God's perspective. Otherwise, it will cause a lot of you can never solve it. You can never quantify the marriage. You can never monetize the marriage. The moment you do that, it's failed. And based on this ruling that they have made, it's going to create a lot of problems. One, if I'm going to get married to, let's say, Susan, I'll first look at, what property do I have now?
Exactly.
Now, I'll keep secrets from her. I won't share anything to do with my property, and she won't have anything to do with.
So the country would have lost the oneness in the family.
Exactly.
Because certainly we are talking about the oneness, but when we come to divorce, the oneness principle seems to be ignored by everyone.
I mean, it would even create like people to do like those prenup agreements that, you know what, we are getting married, but this is what I have, and this is what you have. And now it removes all the perspectives of what God actually has purposed for marriage.
I know you have experienced some of the cases where actually some married people or some people have faced schemers. Going by Lady Justice Catherine's rule judgment on the matter, certainly you risk having people coming to marry for 2 years and then want to walk away with the 50% of the property that you have sweated for I don't know how many years. Is that real ruling being fair, and how do people who are in these marriages get protected from the schemers?
Okay, I have to say first and foremost that that language about quote unquote schemers is something
they
that
do exist. They do exist.
That being said, if you look at our line of jurisprudence, that trend in how courts have actually been deciding these cases, they have been taking into account that it has been 50-50. So Justine Catherine Bamgemere was not the first judge to make that kind of 50-50 ruling. It has been 50-50, and as long as, you know, it was very clear that both parties have contributed to this marriage, whether direct financial contribution or indirect financial contribution, which is both the unpaid care work and all the emotional investment that goes into a marriage. Now, they have been looking at exceptional circumstances. One of the cases that was actually referred to in this very judgment is the case of Rabinomi versus Bahimbi Somwe. It's one of the lead judgments on matrimonial property at the point of divorce. And they would take into, they took into account the fact that this is a marriage that had only lasted a year. So, you know, they looked at, that's when they then got into issues of direct monetary financial contribution. So our courts have actually been, they have been
flexible.
They have been flexible and striking a balance. So in
so
that
they make pronouncements based on the facts and on the circumstances.
Yes. And the, so the default was 50-50, unless otherwise. So the unless otherwise would, for example, be such circumstances, for instance, where the marriage has only been a marriage that has lasted 1 year or 2 years, right? But now, like for this particular case, sincerely, where the couple was living together since 1989, I do not think that that 50-50 would have been unfair for a case such as this.
How would, for example, Joseph get compensated for the school fees at that time that he paid to Jacqueline?
You know, I like how you're bringing up the issue of school fees.
Yeah, because it's a very...
But I can assure you.
Yes.
On average, how much do you think, on average, how much do you think he would have spent on her tuition?
If we are to go that way, certainly, even if it's 100 shillings somebody paid you in 1989, would be much more even, you know, important than a person giving you a million today. Because today you can get it, then you couldn't.
No.
If you had to go by that.
Exactly.
Yes.
No, but you see, that brings back to the issue of you can't monetize issues that have to do with what the other party contributed to the marriage. I can assure you that if we are to go by, for example, American standards in terms of the value of care work, I will not use Ugandan standards because we all know that they are unfair, surely. People are paid, households are paid 50,000 for work that is very, very, you know, tiring and labor intensive. But if you were to go by American standards, you know that most people there don't even have caretakers or house helps in their homes because that is like $20 an hour, right? So if we are to go by those standards and you calculate and compare what, in actual sense, the woman's contribution was vis-a-vis the school fees, because that's like the only thing that this man actually did for her, if you talk about direct monetary contribution,
but he
right?
He was feeding her, he was sheltering her.
Yeah, but she was the one cooking the food. She was the one keeping the home clean.
Let me bring in Pastor. And would these lawyers, for example, argue the same, you know, would they submit the same similarly if, for example, it was the other way around? What constitutes... you know, matrimonial property, mostly looked, the people tend to look at it from a man's property. They have even Uganda saying, "Walo sente ya chichara."
Yeah.
Would it actually be the same interpretation if the court, because I think the court also looked at it from a point that the property, you know, belongs to a man and then has to be shared 50-50. What happens in case a woman gets into a marriage with a property that she has been having, and then time comes for divorce, will this property be divided 50%?
In fact, the debate has been on the man's side.
Exactly.
And I'm not seeing how the debate is coming with the woman's property. Because, I mean, you could have also a property that you bought privately.
Yes.
And then I could have my property that I bought privately.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the issue is, we are only looking at sharing
the man's property.
And but the Bible, you see, gives a clearance. Because when you look at in the Old Testament, in I think Genesis 2, where God said that a man and a woman shall leave their home and then be together. So which means that they are making a home together.
Yes.
So we are looking at these people who are maybe still youthful and they want to, you know, get married, you know, experience the power of God and all that. Now, in this perspective where you go into sharing of property, it becomes a little bit tricky because this generation has changed it. You find a woman is is already, she's rich, maybe she's wealthy, maybe her family is wealthy.
You get to marry Susan, she already has her property.
Yeah, she has her property.
Yes. But the court does not consider her property matrimonial. But my property is considered matrimonial because it's coming from a man.
Yeah, the reason the reason why it would be that in that context is that it is a man that is marrying.
Exactly.
Not a woman, marrying.
Marrying.
Now, what would consider maybe matrimonial property would be if a woman acquired this property while we are in this home and we have consented that actually we shall, you know, have a share. But it's a full responsibility of a man to take care of a woman, to ensure that she gets everything. That's how God has said it. And what brings a big problem in the family is that they have gone beyond the scripture. Okay, people have gone beyond what they're supposed to be doing in their homes. Mm-hmm. A man should take their role, and a woman should take their role.
Which Frida actually opposes. You are equal. You have to share the same roles,
I mean, a woman is supposed to be a helper in a home. You know, this is the Bible definition. And helper does not show that she's supposed to be either cooking only. I could have a property that I'm buying, and maybe she also has some money. She can make a contribution. She has helped me in acquiring this wealth. Are you getting my point?
Yes.
So in the end, if it is a Christian couple, I wouldn't advise them to divorce, because actually God doesn't look at that. But you look at the other society where people are not really having God in them, and they want, you know, to part ways. So in that manner, they should sit down. I think the court ruling was a little bit unfair, depending on the
men. On the circumstances.
On the circumstances and how many years they spent. And the thing is that the contribution should not be, you know, quantified
in monetary terms.
Yeah, in monetary terms, because you cannot quantify the feelings. Because I also come and tell you, I know I had to put all my feelings, I left all the women out there,
yes.
I had to concentrate on you. So if the woman is saying, I'm concentrating on you now, you see it's 50-50.
Mm.
So because there is where we have left, there are people I left before I came to you, she has the people she left, so we have concentrated on this marriage together.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe if we don't have God like on the other side of the couple, I would say 50-50 would be
ordeal.
Mm. Yeah.
All right, Susan, this whole conversation looks to be one-sided. You seem to be looking at a property from a man's direction, because what is considered in our society, matrimonial property, is the property that is owned by a man, because it's the man that is marrying. But your properties, and even this is the discussion that we find in taxis, in workplaces, in a centre child, and even on social media, you find people saying, when you have 20,000, and then the other one also has 20,000. How much does the family have? The family is having 20,000 or 15,000. The woman's money is not calculated there.
Yeah.
Is this ruling actually putting into consideration the protection of a man in such circumstances? For example, Joseph. Is Joseph being protected? And is he not actually being, oppressed under the circumstances? Let's have actually reactions there from this very, very short break. This is the big issue. We are discussing the recently passed judgment by the Court of Appeal about matrimonial property. Welcome back to The Big Issue. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. We are discussing the recently passed judgment by the Court of Appeal on matrimonial property. And with me in studio are two distinguished guests. Susan Baluka is the legal officer at Uganda Women's Lawyers Association, and also Asha Namanya, a pastor at Trinity Christian Church in Rubaga. Before we leave for a break, Susan, I was asking you, let's try to switch the facts and say it is the other way around. It is Joseph that is seeking 80% or 50% rather of the property that was owned by, you know, by Jacqueline. Would the court actually have ruled similar in this matter, assuming it was the other way around, or it is just because the man is not protected in our society?
Thank you, Mubarak, for that question. So how you have presented this issue, it goes back to society's views of gender roles, right? So in society, it is understood that a man is the one who is supposed to provide financially, and the woman is supposed to be the homemaker. Now, that is, those are the traditional
perceptions
and setups and values within our society. But when the law is being developed, when the law is being applied, as it was being developed and applied by this president in this case, it does not look at sex per se. So if the judgment would still have been the same if, ideally, as a matter of principle, it would still have been the same if it was the other way around and the property was in the names of the woman. So it is not that that they made this decision because it was a man. However, why we bring gender into this conversation, these kinds of conversations, is because of what is the reality, what actually happens. We still go back to the reality, right? And say that the court
women
should still look at this from
vulnerable.
Yes, exactly. And I like how, I think the segment before, there was a doctor who said something about divorce will never be fair. And the question is, who is it unfair to? In most cases, if you do a survey, who will be most affected if this kind of ruling becomes the norm and the kind of precedent that should be applied?
So it will never be fair. The judgment of Lady Justice Catherine Bamugemeyi was unfair to the man. Now this is unfair to the woman.
No, the judgment of Lady Justice Catherine. How can you say it was unfair if it was 50-50? I mean, what more fair? How more fair can you get than 50-50?
It's unfair because the man contributed much more than the woman.
No,
yes.
But you see
that makes it unfair.
You see, if you say that the man contributed much more than the woman because he's the one that had the cash, then it goes back to the conversation we were having about the undervaluing of unpaid care work, the undervaluing and undermining of the role of the woman. So, in other words, for the party that does not bring money to the table, she's useless, or they are, or he is useless.
Well,
I mean,
useless.
There
she's,
are instances.
She's 20%. She's not
no,
useless.
No. It's in other words, you're saying that the non-monetary contribution is not as valuable as the monetary contribution.
But
even
when you mention these non-monetary contributions, it looks like the man does not have non-monetary contributions to the family. He also has emotions. He actually supports you emotionally. He gives you whatever that you want. He takes care. He thinks about you.
Now,
but you don't quantify that. But you're looking at, we cook, we take care of children.
No, I mean, it's important. And I was just giving you the example that if we are to go by standards where care work is highly valued, I was just telling you before that in those overseas countries, people cannot afford to have
where men are not protected, mostly.
No, why are you saying they're not protected? It is about valuing both people. And the issue here is that clearly these kinds of judgments are saying that the party to a marriage that brings in the non-monetary work. I know you have said that the man also has brings
some
emotions, you know,
yes,
in terms of his emotional input, which is debatable, first and foremost. because it's on a case-by-case basis. It's on a case-by-case basis. It's on a case-by-case okay, sometimes.
Yes.
But like you have said, you can't quantify that. Now, for the women, in addition to the emotional, okay, fine, if you have to look at it from the way you want to bring it, in addition to the emotional input, now we also do this other care work and input that we do. Not to mention the highly risky childbearing role that we play.
We need to come back to the child rearing, you know, role. Well, let me first get in, Pastor, actually, to interrogate this issue. Would the judgment have been different? For example, if it is what is, if we are to switch facts and you put a woman on the in the shoes of the man and you put the man in the shoes of a woman.
Now, if you switch the role.
Yes.
Okay, of course, it wouldn't be real. But in this case, but I've seen nowadays women marrying men, which is wrong.
Exactly.
And in that case, it means, okay, in that case, because we have seen...
Okay, women, men marry women when women already have property.
Yes, exactly. Mm. No, they are not marrying them. In most cases, you find like a woman is marrying a man because they are wealthy. You've seen you've seen this generation. Things are changing up. And the challenge is that we have never, I've not seen anywhere where they are saying now, let's share the property of this woman who married this young man.
Exactly. Mm.
Are you getting the point?
I've never seen also that case.
Now you see, now that's where we have loopholes in the law. The challenge here I'm seeing is that they are trying to make a whole marriage look like an employment. Now, that's a wrong perspective, because if you go into unpaid care, I had to give birth, I had to... It's like now you're saying you were employed to give birth in the first place. So you don't believe in this marriage. You came as an expert. I'm just responding to what she was saying. So for me, I would think the perspective of, let's say, unpaid care and all that, it's a wrong one. And I know that if women, they were in the role of a man, you see, even with their Kasumu money, they say, savage Kasumu.
Yes.
They don't want even you to see where it is. So if imagine she's the man. I don't think she would be in position to release 50%. That's my opinion.
Because I'm trying to read in the minds of the panel of these justices, for example. They are part of our society. And of course, they don't you think that actually they looked at these facts and this case and never considered the vulnerability of a woman in these circumstances? And certainly, Lady Justice Catherine looked at the vulnerability of a woman and the circumstances of this case and came up with such a ruling.
Yeah, I think it was unfair. I think it's it's unfair judgment. Because we have lived together for 59 years?
About
40 years. Those are many years. So I think the ruling should have been 50-50, because, I mean, you won't quantify unpaid care, and also the other... The fact that she paid school fees, it does not quantify the amount of time that I've also put in, because I could, maybe this woman, I don't know whether she was working or not, but if she was also told to live and be at home, where she paid salary by the husband and all that, so there is no equal sharing in between there.
Absolutely.
Yeah, recently I had a chance, because you see what is making the law fail is because they are not getting a God's perspective, or what we call religious perspective, into the play. They use feelings to regulate or legislate and all that. So I happened to meet the director for legislation in the parliament about the marriage bill, which is about to come. It was first brought by Mrs.
2009.
It was in 2018.
Marriage and divorce.
Yeah, marriage and divorce.
It was brought back to 2012.
Then 2017. Now it's coming back because I saw Honorable Penn moving like a motion about it. And so I was interested. I was like, no, women are supposed to be protected in the other way. Because you realize that sometimes they chase them away without anything.
Yes.
A man wakes up in the morning, he's not interested in the marriage. The woman had waste. And sometimes men are somehow selfish. I know men might not take it to heart, but sometimes they become a little bit selfish. Okay, you came to this young girl, you got married to her, then after 10 years, you're no longer maybe interested. There are some other issues that have upset you.
Or you want another woman.
Yeah, you want another woman, and women are being born every day. You're seeing young girls in campus. Now, you send her away without any compensation. And most women are ignorant of the future of the law. Some of them, they just go back to their villages to see their mother. They cry. Some those are the cases that we have even in churches. We have to pray for them, counsel them out. And for me, I think that's where the problem is. One,
using the law to determine things that ordinarily don't even require.
Yeah, the law shouldn't actually tell that. Because you see, even if it is should, then it should be on equal basis. Because at the end of the day, when you try to say, I've contributed 50%, 80%, 20%, now you're removing the perspective of God. God is in the pocket now. It's like now the law has put God in the pocket.
You just invoke him when you want.
Invoke him when you want something.
Or
when
convenience.
Convenience. Now, that's very bad. And it's breaking up the marriages. And I think the biggest issue now is that the couples are not well, you know, streamlined to love God, to have a perspective. Because when you love God, you can't go in this circus we're seeing here.
Many of the and this discussion, Susan and Asha, many of the discussions that have been in the public after this whole conversation is about genuine couples and schemers. You didn't want to use that
the
word.
The fraud. Yes.
It happens either way. There are men who come to your life seeking for to actually get your property. And there are also women who come to your life seeking to get your property. Now, some women in this town, when they get into marriage, it's like they have hit a jackpot. And after being in marriage for 4 years, they want to claim the 50% of the matrimonial property, including the property that you might have accumulated together. But ordinarily, if she was alone, she wouldn't have accumulated it. She wouldn't have gotten that amount. How should men or women be protected from these fraudsters if we are to go by the other previous judgment of 50%, Susan?
I'll respond to that question by reiterating that previously the trend in judgments has been 50-50. So even saying, talking about all this quote unquote schemers business,
jackpot hitters.
whatever. I mean, those are things that also courts took into account. How long has this marriage been? So that if you're to talk about, fairness, they have looked at that. So they have been looking at that. That has been the trend. And even in one of the cases, this particular court highlighted, that was how, you know, because the marriage had just been for 1 year. So that is something that they took into account. But then to get that and apply it to a situation where someone has been with you for over 40 years,
yes,
that is just completely unfair, honestly. So, but also I think one of the things that needs to be done is to actually put in place legislation that clearly indicates you know, rights upon upon marriage upon dissolution of a marriage or upon divorce. And which I think those now should be the things that should come out very clearly with extensive consultation from all interest groups, taking into account the vulnerabilities of different categories of people, especially women, in such scenarios that have to do with what happens at the point of divorce. Because then all this shift in decisions is because we are looking at common
different
law.
Different circumstances,
but also because we are looking at common law. We don't have an act of parliament in place,
but
which says A, B, C, D, and
your parliamentarians brought it last time in a very unfair manner, and that's why the public was against it.
Actually,
the public was against it in that form, because what Lady Justice's ruling, you know, just judgment was, it was reflecting the contents of the proposed bill that the public outrightly rejected.
Actually, the public, I remember one of the greatest setbacks for having that marriage and divorce bill, which was before even what we call the domestic relations bill, was because actually the parliament listened to religious leaders. Religious leaders were saying, you cannot come and legislate on divorce in a same law which is talking about
marriage.
Also, I believe that same law in its previous form, I think this has been going on since 2003, actually. So in this previous form, it was also taking into account situations of cohabitation.
Yes.
And also, that one was vehemently opposed. Then also, on the other hand, we have the Muslim community,
yes,
where they said, no, please, for us, you cannot bundle us
yes.
in the same, you know, secular laws. For us, we shall be governed by what the Sharia says.
But Susan, as we are winding up, you know, when you're protecting, especially the rights of women, sometimes you go extreme. and radical, and leave a man unprotected. You leave the man helpless and vulnerable in this matter. You are actually, your role is to make sure that people are having fair and, you know, fair judgment and equal share in most of these kind of circumstances. But you, especially women activists, go to the extreme and you leave men really helpless. Are we learning something in this judgment? Wasn't the court trying to protect the man's sweat for what actually he fought for in a long time?
I'll respond to that with the same question that you asked before. If the roles were switched, as a man, would you be happy to take 20% when you have comforted your wife for all those years, given her emotional support in her work while she was acquiring all that wealth, picking the children from school, taking care of them? Would you be happy to just walk away with 20%?
Mm-hmm.
As a man, would you? As a man who provides, you know, plays a care role, as a man who, you know, provides emotional support to his wife, would you be happy to walk away with 20%?
Certainly, if the man had, you know, if the woman had her property, I would be satisfied with the 20%.
No, but in this particular case, we're talking about property that was acquired during the marriage. It just so happens that the paper of ownership only has the woman's names, but
no,
you are
the
there. I'm just saying if the roles were switched.
Yes, exactly.
The property has the woman's names. However, you were there when she was, you know, you were taking care of the kids while she was busy looking for the
man. Unfortunately, we're running out of time. Pastor Namanya,
yes.
What lessons are we picking? And what should be in the mind of all those people who are thinking about divorce?
Now, maybe just respond just in a few minutes about what she's saying. Okay, I think God respects, you know, the government and all the policies. Of course, when you read in Romans 13 and 14, you see that we should respect the leaders. So the church also respects the government policies and what is being made. But they need a guidance on how to regulate. Because in matters where someone has lived with someone for more than 40 years, it's unfair to come and say, let them get 20% or 10%, because, I mean, it's a span of so many years.
Yeah.
But in cases where you want to protect the fraudsters, because I know they are there, this is the world, and the devil is working. So you would find somebody has come just in 1 year, but, you know, she was targeting the jackpot, when the man, maybe the man is rich, or the man also targeted the woman because
when
she's
the woman
rich.
Is rich. Mm.
Yeah, so in such circumstances, that's where now the law comes in to protect the either have rights to private property, and then maybe the issue of matrimonial property, there it will be defined by the law well and articulated and how many years. Because you see, it does not even give a definition how many years you've spent in that marriage. At least they should do consultation with religious or the church to also guide through and also go and consult different people on the matter. But what lessons do we learn? One, apparently there is no... You can see that there is little God. God is pocketed. They have put him in a pocket. So, if the couple begins to think about a divorce, it means that God is in the pocket.
Yes,
that is number one lesson that you can learn. Two, of course, there is legislation is now based on the mood. Of course, if the judge is in the mood today, maybe
has also a cases.
Or maybe a friend, or maybe a relative also passed through the same scenario, they might use that, you know, as a mood to make a judgment, which is very wrong, and it should be factual. So I think we need to guide the nation on how to carry out the marriage, especially the church. We need to guide our couples, counsel them. They shouldn't think even about divorce, because when you are coming to God or to Christ, you should think of center the home on Christ.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Susan, as we are winding up, people are actually getting to this whole mess. Is this the time in lessons learned for actually families and people in the marriages to start registering their properties in their names, and this whole thing called matrimonial property can as well be settled before even we get into litigation?
Thank you, Mubarak. For me, I think since we are trying to get to a place where we are saying that it doesn't matter in whose names the property is registered, I think perhaps the best thing is to, quote unquote, one, for an individual before they get into marriage, to know what are the implications.
Absolutely.
What are the financial implications? What are the economic implications upon marriage, upon dissolution of the marriage? And I think right now we need to empower people with information and inform them as much as possible so that they can then know before they get into this.
Absolutely.
But that said, it then goes back to if people find themselves in what we call marriage, then what? It is important that we have in place legislation that actually protects
everyone.
Everyone.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Susan, from the Uganda Lawyers Association, Uganda Women Lawyers Association, FIDA, and Pastor Asha Namanya of Trinity Christian Church, Lubaga. Thank you so much for coming to join me in this whole conversation. But all the married couples out there, if you're thinking about divorce, think twice, as Pastor has been saying, because it's not all the time that you have your way. You've lived with somebody's daughter for 35 years. You send this daughter away to a family which sometimes might even have been removed. Her parents might have died. You got this girl when she's 19 years. She's now 52, and you want her to get away with only 20%? Besides the ruling and the conversation that is going on, think about this person, because she's not going to have another youthful time to make her choices right. That's just a word of caution for those who are thinking about marriage and divorce. Now, I want to take a very short break, but before we do that, Eddie Kenzo was nominated in the Global Grammy Awards. It's quite a prestigious nomination, and Maestro Amit is coming back with that conversation with Eddie Kenzo. My name is Mubarak Mugabo. See you tomorrow.